In this video, we're going to be talking about Spring Profiles. We're going to start by defining a profile on a bean, and we're going to start by using the profile annotation. We're then going to move to XML, and finally, we're going to look at how we can define a negative profile. Next, we're going to have a look at how to activate profiles, and we're going to start with a programmatic way of doing that, and there are a few ways to do it. One is via the web application initializer interface, and another is using the configurable environment abstraction. Now, programmatic setting of profiles can happen anywhere in the application, and these are just two good ways to do that. And finally, we're going to be looking at some other methods to set up and activate profiles. So one, in a web application, we can use the web XML and we can use a context parameter to do that. We can also use a JVM system parameter. We can use an environment variable. And finally, in tests, we can use the active profile annotation. All right, so let's start with a practical use case and let's have a look at how we can define two beans, two separate beans, implementing the same interface, but belonging to two different profiles. So we can immediately see that these two beans are just example beans. We are defining the profile annotation here, and we are making the dev data source configuration belong to the dev profile, and we are making the production data source configuration belonging to the production profile. Now, this is pretty straightforward, and based on which of these profiles is active at runtime, either the dev data source config or the production data source config is going to be enabled in the Spring context. Now, it is important that these two profiles, dev and production, are mutually exclusive. So we shouldn't define both of them and we shouldn't enable both of them at runtime at the same time. Okay, let's now have a look at the same exact example, the same two beans, but now defined in XML configuration. So we have the two beans defined here. We have the two profiles, dev and production. So we can immediately see that which profile is enabled will determine which of these two beans is active at runtime. And of course, the same note as before stands, the dev and production profiles, in this case at least, are mutually exclusive and should not be both enabled at the same time. Finally, when it comes to profile definitions, let's have a quick look at how we can define a negative profile. So in our case here, we have the production data source config, and this belongs to the production profile. Now, if we want to change that, and if we want to say this bean needs to belong to any other profile than, for example, the development profile, we could use negation dev. And that's going to make the bean actually belong to any other profile than dev. If dev is active, this bean will not get created. If, however, the dev profile is not active, this bean will be created and will be in the Spring context. And of course, this kind of notation will come in handy in some scenarios. Let's now start looking at how we can actually enable the profiles in a Spring application. And we are going to start with a web application, provided the web app is using Servlet 3.0 or above, 3.1. This would be a very simple web application initializer that we can use to actually set the profiles, the active profiles in the application. So we can use the servlet context that we have available here to set this init parameter. And we're going to set the default key for active profiles, and we are going to basically enable the dev profile. So related to our previous example, in this case, we are enabling the dev profile and not the production profile. Let's now have a look at the other programmatic way of setting profiles inside the Spring application. And this is the configurable environment abstraction. So first of all, we're going to do everything inside this test. We're going to create this context here out of the previous XML example we looked at, the one where we were defining two versions of this bean, one in the dev profile and the other in the production profile. So we have created this context. We are then getting the environment out of this context, and we are setting dev as the active profile. And we are, of course, refreshing this context. So at this point, we should have the dev implementation, the dev data source configuration implementation of our bean. So we're going to get this by the interface, not knowing which of these implementations we're going to get. And we're going to assert that this is indeed the dev data source configuration. So that means the profile became active and we are seeing the right implementation of this bean. So let's have a run. And of course the test passes and we are getting the right implementation of this bean, which is the dev implementation. Let's now have a look at the other way of setting the active Spring profiles in a web application. And this is the web.xml file. We can simply use a context parameter here and we can set the Spring active profiles to whatever profiles we need. In this case, we are setting them to the dev profile, but comma delimited allows us to do any number of profiles. So I can set here profile 2, and this is going to be parsed out correctly into two different profiles. Next, let's have a look at how we can set the profile with a JVM system parameter. And this is of course a low-level solution, but in this case we're just going to use Eclipse and we are going to look at the run configuration of this Tomcat server. We're going to open the launch configuration here and we can pass in any profiles we want just like this. So we are passing in the Spring profile active equals dev and this is going to be a VM argument. Low level and pretty simple. And of course the comma delimited option applies here as well. I can list out profile number 2 and profile number 3 and these are going to be correctly parsed out by Spring into separate profiles. And finally, let's have a look at how to activate a profile or a set of profiles inside a test. So we are going to use the active profile annotation here to activate the dev profile inside this test. And as you can see, we are injecting the data source configuration bean here, again, not knowing which of these implementations we are going to get. This is based on the profile, and the test is basically asserting that we are getting the right implementation. So the dev profile does determine that we're getting the dev data source configuration bean here. So let's run this. And of course it is successful, and the profile is correctly activated here. So quite a few interesting ways of first defining the profiles on beans and then activating the profiles at runtime. If you liked this video and you want to get more of these tactical focused lessons, go ahead and subscribe to the channel. Thank you and see you in the comments.